From the nation's capital, this is the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast with your host, Rob Snowett.
Thank you for downloading the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast. This is Series 2, Episode 63, Fly South Nashville. Fly South is Nashville's premier fly fishing shop. Their midtown location is at 115 19th Avenue South. Over 20 years of experience outfitting, guiding, and teaching anglers in the Mid-South. They offer a complete array of services, including guided fly fishing trips, casting instruction, fly tying classes, fly fishing classes, and fly fishing schools. I sat down with Jim on a recent summer morning, and we discussed all things Fly South. You can find them at flysouth.net. This podcast, even though it was recorded in another fly shop, is being brought to you by Risen Fly. Quality fly fishing gear that will rival the big companies, but keep some extra money in your pocket. Rods, reels, lines, accessories, and so much more. Be sure to let them know you heard about them on the podcast. And by now, being this is the third time we've had them sponsor a podcast in a row, you should be receiving your fly box, the double silicone floating waterproof one. If not, get on risenfly.com and order one right now. Do it. Trust me. It's the best fly box I've ever owned. All right, Jim, where are we right now?
So we're in Nashville, Tennessee, sitting in the theater room at Fly South.
Tell me about this room. This is pretty cool.
Yeah, so we came into this space about 7 years ago, and for 30-some-odd years, it was a high-end kind of audio-visual place. At one time, they sold all the digital tape to Music Row. But in the end of their business, they were in the selling home theaters for your house. So when we came into the space, there were six theater rooms set up, and so we kept one of them.
It's pretty cool. The sound in here is pretty awesome for recording too.
Yeah, it's all all sound panels and
Jason's gonna like this.
the screen was here. Unfortunately, they didn't leave any of their nice high end audio stuff. But the screen was here. We found these seats. A church was replacing their choir seats, so we found these seats from them. And then the upholstery on these seats were curtains from another theater room in here.
How about that?
Yeah. So been repurposed twice, actually, because the owner before us said those curtains came out of a funeral home that they had repurposed in the curtains for one of the screening rooms, and then we repurposed them for these seats.
Do you have classes in here? Do you just show movies?
Classes in here. Speakers will kind of plug in here. Oddly enough, a lot of our customers will use it for presentations to their clients or to their training and staff. We'll kind of let anyone use it. If you're a customer, we don't really charge you to use it. But it's amazing. If three new people discover what we carry, it always translates into new customers.
Anybody mistake that jar of cicada shucks for snacks during the movie and start crunching on them?
If you pass it around, they probably wouldn't know. Yeah. Yeah.
And, of course, you got the hot chicken joint across the street, so you have a lot of signs in your parking lot.
A lot of signs. We fight parking. Just Nashville is growing so fast, and a lot of free parking that used to be around the city is going away now. And so, yeah, we have to protect our parking a little bit.
Nice.
But, we have parking in front of the building and behind. A lot of our customers don't realize that we do have some spaces behind. But
my wife didn't even park. I had it like tuck and roll. She's like, open the door and get out.
Get out, yeah.
All right, let's talk about the shop, maybe before the fishery. So what are some of the brands you carry here?
We carry too many brands, is what a lot of my manufacturers would say. But You know, in stock, we typically have about 300 different fly rods in stock. So we carry Sage, Scott, Winston, Loomis, Reddington, Echo. What am I leaving out?
It's a good amount.
St. Croix. Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Do you carry rods for around the world versus just to fish locally?
And no, for around the world. And we've got a diverse fishery, so it kind of demands a broader selection. But we're also, you know, we're only 7 hours from tarpon fishing in the panhandle here. We're only, you know, 10 hours to the Great Lakes steelhead stuff. A lot of people don't realize, like, the proximity of Nashville. And we've got small mountain streams close. We've got big southern tailwaters. We have saltwater all within a day's drive. And so, you know, it doesn't take too long to get to a lot of different things.
And your fly selection shows that. You've got a little bit of everything.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, it's like we have a, you know, the Bahamas are close. You know, it's an easy flight to Mexico from here. You know, we have a lot of guys that go up and fish the eastern seaboard every year. You know, there's a contingent of Great Lakes guys. So, yeah, it's, you know, what do you want? We've got it.
That's fantastic.
Yep.
Pretty good fly tying room.
Yeah. You know, I grew up in Denver. So growing up in Denver when I was young, there was some great shops that had great fly tying selections. And then all of that started to fade as a lot of shop owners realized they could make more money on hats and t-shirts than they could feathers. And so I started to see these great shops with great tying selections start to shrink that. But that was the reason why I would go in every week was, you know, to get a new patch of hair or feathers or hooks. And in that, you would see what was new in the rest of the shop or see what the shop guys were excited about. So I used to tie professionally kind of through college just to support my fishing habit, and which took me into a lot of shops. But in the back of my mind, I always thought, man, if I ever open a fly shop, it's going to have a good fly tying selection. And we've always kind of stuck to that principle. There's not a lot of shops that carry a broader range and as deep a tying selection as we do.
Right now in DC, if you want to go find blue or pink or green S-Taz, good luck. You might get like a color of brown. Maybe you can't even find like olive marabou in DC. It's tough.
Yeah. You know, and a lot of what we do isn't very profitable, but again, we're all tires in here and we're all passionate about it. So, you know, I hate dying, but, you know, we're kind of forced to dye certain colors because you can't get them. Again, it's hard to set your shop apart from other shops. When you're all kind of carrying the same hard goods, you know, if you walk into a Sage dealer or walk into a Winston dealer, they're going to have whatever's current from those, you know, two vendors. So finding things that every other shop in the country doesn't have is hard, but we try and work at it so that, you know, when you do walk in here, there is something that you're not going to see in every other shop in the country.
Right. What's new and notable in the tying that people are excited about in the shop?
You know, I'll tell you, there's little trends in tying. And so for us, the last several years, and it's because of our musky fishery and then our striper fishery.
Is that all because of the TVA and the dams they built back in the last century?
So the striper component of that is, yes. Musky, there used to be a native musky on the plateau here. So it didn't get as big as the northern strain, but they were here. And the Tennessee Wildlife Resource Agency has spent numerous years trying to put musky back up on the plateau. So there's several streams that have them. You know, most people, when you hear about muskie in our part of the world, they're talking about the Collins, the Upper Caney fork system. That's where the tournament started and is held every year. So a lot of people are fixated on that fishery. Yes, Hardly Strictly. Yeah, yep. That's it. So because of those things, a quality bucktail has been what our trend has been for the last couple
long
seasons.
Ones back in there.
Yeah, and you know, I need to get to dying because I got some people screaming at me because we're out of colors. But yeah, so that has been a trend. You know, we're seeing. So we always lag behind the West in trout trends. So a lot of the Euro style competition stuff is moving into this part of the world. There's been a little pocket over in North Carolina, Smoky Mountains area. So we're seeing a lot more demand for jig hooks and those style of flies. So pretty opposite spectrum there from, you know, big bucktail streamers to, you know, to small competition style nymphs. But those are the two trends that we've seen here.
A lot of articulation.
You know, yeah, a lot of articulation and you know, quite frankly, you know, over-articulation, which, you know, it's good for me, you know. But, yeah, you see, that has been a trend. That's starting to fade a little bit, though. I think a lot of guys are realizing that they take longer to tie, and something that has six articulated pieces in it doesn't really fish any better. Maybe that something has three. So you're seeing some of that get reined in, not so excessive in articulation.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
What about rods? Anything new that's coming out in the industry you're excited about?
You know, all my guys are pretty excited about Salt HD. The X from Sage still has a lot of kind of legs to it. You know, the Asquith, believe it or not, even though it's so pricey. Expensive, has been better than kind of we thought it would. You know, the Meridian and the Radian are still strong from Scott. Yeah, that's kind of been our trend a little bit. Yeah.
Anything new with fly lines that you're enjoying?
You know, I tell you, the fly lines have gotten so complicated, which is great, but a lot of consumers don't realize how complicated they've become, which translates into how much a line can either help you or kill the action of the rod, or whatever you're trying to do. So, you know, some nice stuff people may not have noticed were single-hand spay lines last year, actually are really great lines for doing a lot of things that we do.
I've got the OPST for my 5-weight.
Yep.
I can just bomb out a single roll cast and shoot 60, 70 feet from the bank.
Yeah, yep.
But I've learned you can't strip that line. I have the laser line.
Yeah.
You can't strip it in.
Right, yeah.
And I broke my laser line broke on a shooting head last December, and my whole shooting head floated downstream. It got caught between a rock, and the current just popped it, and I just saw that whole brand new head. Yeah. Just like, oh my goodness! Yeah.
You know, it's funny. That's where the trend in lines have been kind of shorter and heavier, a lot more weight, a lot quicker in the head, which I've never really been a fan of. So you're seeing some trends kind of move away from that again. Rio's new Flats Pro line, I think, is going to be really good. I have not fished it yet, so I'm saying this without having been on water with it yet, but playing around with it on some water and casting it, I really like the feel of that line right now. I think that's going to be a good line for saltwater this year. You know, trout lines, we do a lot of small stuff here, especially through the summer. So, you know, I just kind of like a true line weight, line that's going to present the fly, you know, where I want it and easily. Our kind of smallmouth streamer guys, they like a little front-loaded, shorter head. just because our smallmouth water here in this part of the state is smaller. It's not like some of the big Northeast streams, even some of the streams, you know, kind of Upper East Tennessee. It's almost like trout pocket water in some of our smallmouth streams around here. So if you're trying to throw a little heavier fly, trying to get a crayfish down, trying to turn over a bait fish pattern, and you don't have a lot of room, you got to get that rod loaded up. So my true smallmouth guys like a little softer rod and a little more weight in the front end of the line. Yeah.
I'm always happy with like the Rio.
Rio
outbound.
Makes a good line. Yeah. Yeah. Outbound well, a lot of guys fish outbound shorts.
It makes the worst caster be able to chuck something far.
Yeah. Well, it just gets everything loaded up. Yeah.
It's
yeah.
Nice. What about some soft goods? I noticed you have the sacks.
Yes.
My buddy was telling me I need to get a pair of those.
You know, it's...
If you want to explain what those are for the gentleman listening.
So it's an underwear line out of Canada that essentially has two internal baffles that kind of keep the boys in line. And the outdoor rep that came in here asking if we might be interested, I just kind of passed on him. And then he left some underwear for the staff.
New in the box, I hope?
Yeah, new in the box. Right. And then I was out of town for a couple of days, came back in, and the whole staff was like, you got to order these things, you got to order these things. And I was like, we just don't need another underwear brand in here. And they just kept on pestering me about it. And so he finally sent me a pair, and I tried them, and I was like, okay, these are pretty nice underwear. It's one of those rare brands that... If you can get someone to try them, they will come back on their own and buy more. And
do people mail order them through your shop?
No. It's mostly our customers that
walk in.
And I'll give you an example. An old customer of mine, he was quickly leaving town, and he forgot to pack underwear, and he just stopped in and was like, what do you have? And Zach was like, here, take these. And so he took a couple pair. Left town, came back, and was like, those are the greatest things I've ever worn. Grab some more. And then fast forward to a buddy of his was leaving town and going to Europe. And he's like, you have to try these underwear. We weren't even selling. He's like, you have to try these underwear. He's like, I'm not paying. They're relatively expensive. They're $35, $40 a pair. And he's like, you have to try these underwear. He's like, I'm not buying underwear. And he's like, I'm going to buy you a pair, but you have to wear them. So he bought his friend a pair of underwear who was going to Europe. And he's like, you have to wear them on the plane over. And he did. So 10 days later, he came back into the store, and he walks in and he just starts to laugh. And I was like, Tom, how was your trip? He's like, it was great. And Zach was like, well, how was the underwear? And he's like, he just shook his head and he just kind of chuckled. He goes, give me all of your extra larges. So it's kind of that weird brand in that if you try them, almost everyone comes back and gets another pair. Yeah, I've been doing this a long time. You know, if there's stuff like that happens every now and then where it ends up just selling itself. Yeah.
Word of mouth,
yep. You know, and then, you know,
I'm trying to think of some good testicular puns, but I'm not coming up with any.
they have some pretty clever advertising. But, you know, and they do, you know, for us, the performance, so the ones that will dry quick. I mean, a lot of people, you know, you're wearing a $500, $600, $700 Gore-Tex wader now, and then you're throwing cotton underwear on underneath it. It doesn't make any sense. So, you know, we get beat up a lot for carrying clothing from some of our smaller competitors around. You know, it's like, well, you know, really, if you're the more comfortable you are while you're fishing, especially if you're, you know, fishing here when it's, you know, if you've been here this week, it's been miserably hot. You know, if you don't have clothes that'll move that perspiration off your body and keep, you know, and not have clothes that cling to you, it's miserable. You won't want to be outside. Same thing when it's cold. If you're underwear is holding your perspiration right next to your skin when you're, you know, standing in a cold stream in Alaska, you're going to get cold and you're not going to be as comfortable, which means you're not going to be able to fish as long. So, you know, having performance clothing to go under, you know, your waders that are meant to perform at a certain level is really important. And so, you know, I came out of that outdoor industry. I was an outdoor buyer for 14 years. And so it, you know, that experience kind of carries over to, you know, waders are important, your line's important, your leader's important, but also, you know, if you're serious about this sport, it takes you to a lot of demanding environments. You know, you're a steelhead fisherman, you know? I mean, how many freezing days?
I just bought the Sitka Hudson jacket.
Yeah,
I can't wait to wear that out there.
Exactly.
I'm so happy.
Exactly. You know, so your choice is not to go, to go and be miserable, or to go and be comfortable. And so if you're, if you can go and stay comfortable longer, you know, the likelihood that, that you're going to catch fish is increased, you know, tremendously. So, you know, we believe gear starts, you know, with clothing all the way down to your, you know, fly, tippet, and leader. Yep.
All right. Anything else about the shop before we start talking about your fishery?
You
or
know,
maybe the culture of Nashville? Is there a big fishing crowd here?
You know, it's not... it's not as big as, you know, pick a Western town. It's growing. And it's diverse, like our fishery.
We're just driving here today, I saw a flats boat over by Bolton's.
Yep.
And then we were having coffee and someone with a tow we drove by.
Right, right. And so that's, you know, there's little pockets of fishermen that, you know, they have a particular love. So, you know, I've got guys that they only fish for panfish and they just think that's the greatest thing, you know, in the world. And then obviously there's trout guys, but there's striper guys here. There's musky guys here. We've got gar fishermen and carp fishermen. Yeah. So it's a diverse kind of fishing crowd. Trout still the bulk. It's just the nature of fly fishing. But as much as we fished for a lot of different things over the years, we're finally starting to see other things not get frowned upon. It's what I like about the younger demographic that's finding the sport right now is they get excited about catching chub. They don't really care as long as they're getting something to eat the fly, which if you live here is a great thing. I mean, there's some unique things that happen throughout the year here that are really fun. It's not what you would think about, you know, as classic fly fishing, but you should take advantage of it. You know, we have, you know, there's five or six different carp species to fish here. But in the spring, the buffalo will run to spawn, and it's like a salmon run. You know, so you'll have thousands and thousands of fish move into several different systems to spawn. And so some days they'll chase a streamer. Some days you've got a dead drift of San Juan to them or a small nymph, you know. But, you know, you're looking at fish that are going to be 6 to 30 pounds.
Whoa.
By the thousands. And
that's pretty cool.
Yeah. And, you know, I try and tell guys every year, if you're going to Alaska, you need to fish the buffalo run in April, because then that's exactly what you need to do to catch Pacific salmon.
It's good practice.
It's, yes. And, you
it's
know,
fun.
If you're not tying your knots correctly, then you'll know.
Yeah.
You know, it's right here.
It's like preseason football that's going on right now.
Exactly. It's exactly. And if you don't turn your nose up at it, it's really fun. Yeah, they're not a particularly good looking fish, but
I've only seen them in Ohio.
Yeah, you know, we also fish them. They'll come up in the flats just like a common will and feed and tail and everything. But they are really hard to figure out. You can have 200 perfect shots and not have a fish even look at the fly. And then all of a sudden, a switch will turn on and your next 30 casts will be 30 fish. And nothing changes. They are the weirdest feeders to a fly.
Sounds like a good challenge.
It is. It is. They're
that'd keep me busy.
Yeah, that they're definitely kind of our, I think, one of our toughest fish to catch. You know, and again, because you're looking at actively feeding fish. You know, muskie. You know, if a muskie's in the mood to eat, it doesn't really matter. He's going to eat. Now I know all my all the muskie guys are crying right now, but it's really true. You know, none of those guys fish the same fly twice. None of those guys tiny thing that looks like anything in the river anymore. You're talking about articulated trends. It's like these bigger, you know, bigger, brighter, bigger, longer. And you know, we have as many muskie caught on flies out of the bend as all those big articulated stuff.
We got one on a copper John once. I don't know if we flossed it or what. It was on a 5-weight and there's no net and I didn't want to touch it.
Yeah, right.
It was my first encounter with a muskie and my last. But yeah, that thing scared me.
Yeah. Well, we can take a guy that's never caught a muskie, and if it's the right day in the white, you know, water level, it can take an inexperienced fisherman and get him into a muskie. I can take a really good fisherman onto a carp flat with feeding buffalo, and he can put the fly exactly where it needs to be and not get a sniff. I mean, that's what's great about those fish, but it's also what drives you mad about those fish.
You got to have a whole other arsenal of gear to be a muskie angler.
Yeah, a little bit. Not necessarily. Most of the guys here are fishing. Most of them are 9 and 10 weights. And again, it depends on what you're trying to throw fly wise. A lot of guys have gone to rods that have a little softer tip. Again, it's, you know, in a lot of these systems, they're not very big, so you're not having to make really long casts, depending on where you're fishing for them. So again, trying to load a, you know, if you're trying to throw a 16-inch fly, you've got to get a rod that'll flex. And if you're trying to throw a 16-inch fly only 30, 40 feet away from the boat, then, you need a really front-loaded line and a rod that will bend a little deeper, a little easier. Yeah.
What do you do when you catch one? Do you have, like, hemostats? You have to have a jaw spreader.
Most serious guys will carry a jaw spreader, or just a long hemostat where you know if you just reach down and you know take the fly out.
Are there stories of people getting their hands mangled?
All the time. People get bloody all the time. Oh. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So let's talk about the fishing around here. So we know the species. Where, like, the Cumberland River right here. Is there anything in there?
Well, yeah. So the Cumberland downtown is actually a really good smallmouth fishery. A lot of big smallmouth for this area. Problem with the Cumberland, it's a big, dirty river. You know, it's a lot of sediment in it, and so a lot of people don't think about fishing it. But there's also striper and hybrid in it. There's carp in it. There's largemouth in it. There's gar in it, and it runs right through town here. And really, it doesn't look like it from, you know, when you cross over to the interstate.
It looks really slow.
It is. And again, depending on where you're at and depending on what the volume is, but there are sections that are really beautiful. And it sees a lot of mayfly activity that a lot of people have no idea or is on that river. So, you know, guys that fish it a lot and have figured some of that out, again, you know, what do you want to chase? Panfish, you know, bass, carp. There is skipjack in that river that
skipjack's
like a river. It's like a river herring.
Okay.
And they'll
get. I know them as a like a tuna.
Yeah, it's different. All locals, right. Locals here call them skipjack. It looks like a little tarpon. But when you get into, you know, a school of skipjack that are 3, 4, 5 pounders. And they're the type of fish that you can't strip a fly fast enough to keep it away from them. And, you know, I've been in skipjack boils where you couldn't hear me talking. We're, what are we, 3 feet apart? Yeah. Like, there's just so much, they're just crashing so much bait that it's just mayhem. So, yeah, that's, I mean, that's really fun. You know, in the wintertime here on the Cumberland, out by the Gallatin steam plant, there's a warm water discharge that pulls all the bait in, which then pulls the skipjack in, which then pulls the striper in. And so it becomes, nice. Yeah, it becomes a place where a lot of guys, you know, when our weather's really bad, you can just kind of run out there, either skipjack fish or striper fish, or, I mean, everything congregates there. But
we have sewage outflows.
Yeah, similar. Yeah.
Hot water discharge.
Yeah, where in the cooler months, things like to collect. But in the summer, you'll have, you know, big schools of skipjack doing the same thing.
And you got the football stadium. When they turn those lights on at night during games, are there all sorts of bugs?
Yes.
Are people just, like, swatting stuff all night?
Tennessee's a buggy place. Yeah. Yeah.
I saw the flood pictures. That was underwater inside the stadium.
Yeah.
It was a couple years ago.
Pretty crazy. That was a bizarre weekend, how much it rained in such short order. But so off the Cumberland, there's a lot of tributaries that run into it. And so most of the Harpeth is a big tributary to the Cumberland. It's kind of one of our good smallmouth fisheries that is right here in town. So you have a lot of smaller kind of spring fed smallmouth stuff around. Then you have the big impoundments that, you know, you've got everything, you know, again, panfish to striped bass in. Our closest trout fishing is kind of feet wet in an hour from here. So now you're in the hydroelectric dams that, because of the cold water release every day, they can hold trout all year. And so there's five within a two-hour radius of us, and then you stretch out, you know, another, you know, 3 to 5 hours, you pick up another five kind of over in the eastern half of the state. The Cumberland, as it winds up into Kentucky, there is about 60 miles of trout fishery below Wolf Creek, which is another big hydroelectric dam. That is also kind of a fishery that for Nashville trout guys was significant. It got hurt several years ago because of some dam repair, but it's kind of roaring back to what it typically looked like.
Is it all stocked? Any wild reproduction?
You know, so, yeah, that's the odd thing about southern tailwaters. You know, for a long time, you know, all the biologists would tell you there was no significant reproduction in the southern tailwater. And then by accident, they found natural reproduction in the South Holston, which fishermen have been screaming for years, you got to protect these fish. And so, you know, it was they had never looked for it, but, you know, so they wouldn't commit to saying that there was any, you know, and we didn't have any, you know, scientific data that said, hey, there's reproduction going on, other than if you've been around this a long time, you know what a stock fish looks like relative to a wild fish.
Getting and little ones with par marks on them.
Yeah, so, you know, they found it by pure accident, but depending on which biologist you talk to up in Kentucky, yes, there's natural reproduction or no. There are several year-class fish that definitely go through the motion and spawn. It is, what's the recruitment? You know, what percentage is wild, or if any, and those numbers are a little harder to find. Yeah. But again, southern tailwaters grow fish big, fast.
There's a lot to do with the bug life in there.
You know, and just the diversity of what they can feed on. So typically, in winter months, which has kind of shifted, and I think that has a lot to do with we don't cool down as fast as we used to in the fall. So it used to be an event that would happen somewhere between Thanksgiving and Christmas. Now, the last couple of years has happened later, February, March.
This conversation happens in almost every interview with somebody.
Yeah, it's a little scary in a lot of regard. But we get a shad kill. Which used to be when it would start to get really cold, you'd get threadfin or gizzards that would come through the generators. Well, that's just a huge protein. You know,
getting chopped up, going through the generator.
Chopped up or stunned, and they come through. And so, you know, fish put a lot of weight on when that event happens. They will eat those shad until they're sticking out of their gills. And everything eats them. So you've got that event that happens in the winter. So there's not a lot of winter bugs in a lot of these fisheries, but when you have that.
Do you ever throw flesh flies up there?
Yeah. Yep. A popper this year was outstanding. I mean, it was just a pencil popper was so much fun. So you have that event. And then we were talking about in the Caney Fork, which is our closest, it's kind of Nashville's home trout water. So it's an hour out of town. Well, the buffalo come out of the Cumberland into the Caney to spawn. And so you have, you know, tens of thousands of fish that run into the river. There's a couple different runs of buffalo, and they deposit an egg all over the bottom of the stream bed. So there's another, you know,
egg hatch.
Yeah, and you can watch the trout just eating those eggs off the bottom. You know, you'll catch a fish during that time of year, and they'll cough eggs up, you know, into the boat. The middle part of the state, the Tennessee tailors in the middle, they have bugs, but not as consistent or as blanket a hatch as some of the eastern tailwaters. The Cumberland in Kentucky has really good bugs, but it's kind of a young fishery. And so you don't hear a lot of those guys talking about some of the hatches up there, but they have really good hatches of caddis and mayflies. They have a really good stonefly population up there that we don't have in like the Caney Fork or the Elk. It's really odd depending on the system. You either have really good classic trout bugs or you don't. And the places where you don't, it's typically scud, sow bug, black fly, midges, snails, and then you were talking about the lights at the stadium.
Right.
There's no telling how many different beetle and crane fly and just flying insects that end up in the water here. So when some of the mayfly and caddis kind of die down in the tailwaters around here, you know, you'll see a flying ant hatch that just dumps so many bugs into the water.
Pool. Yeah. Our neighborhood swimming pool had a flying ant hatch, and the kids were freaking out. Every square inch probably had 10 ants, and the kids were just disgusted by it. I thought it was awesome.
Yeah.
I wish I was fishing.
You know, there's June bugs, and there's Japanese beetles, and there's, you know, 20 other flying beetles, and there's all kind of, you know, bees and wasps, and, you know, there's cicadas, and then, you know, we have periodic cicadas also, but, you know, we have dog day cicadas, what they refer to here, every year this time of year.
You've
probably heard them.
Airbnb the other night.
Right, you probably heard them. It was interesting, they were, when the eclipse happened this week, the cicadas just went crazy when it went dark. A lot of, in the middle part of the state, that the trout streams don't look like classic trout streams. So a lot of guys struggle. Like the Caney Fork has no structure in it. So unless you can read water well, a lot of guys struggle at first when they walk into the Caney, because it's like, wow, this is just featureless. Where are the fish going to be? If you like sight fishing with small stuff, it's a wonderful river for that.
Like out west, yeah. Colorado style.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, a lot of fish are caught with, you know, midge patterns. And the Caney, they like it right below the surface. Some days they'll eat off the top. Some days you've got to get it to the bottom. But they will, you know, almost every day from middle June until middle October, if you just had a zebra midge, if you know how to present a fly, you're going to catch fish. Yeah. There has been some water quality improvements that have has moved biomass upstream a little bit, and then also helped with a lot of other things that you would find downriver in our tailwaters. But now that water quality's improved a little bit, that they've moved up. So you start, you know, we're starting to see a lot more little sculpin and darters, some crayfish here and there that you didn't used to see in the Caney Fork, especially. It has a real bad DO problem, typically usually by middle of the summer, depending on how much rain we've had in the spring. So what happens is, if we have a big wet spring, they generate off a lot of the good water, and then we get, you know, by midsummer or by late summer, we're left with really bad dissolved oxygen, and that used to really hold our fishery down a little bit. But the Corps has been instrumental and cooperative, and when that happens, when our DO drops below six parts per million, then they'll kick a sluice gate on, which I'm getting kind of, I don't want to get too lost here, but a sluice gate comes from below the generation tubes, so it's colder water, which helps this time of year, and then how it comes out is so violent that it oxygenates the water a little bit. So we've kind of flattened those temperature swings out, and when the DO drops, they have the ability to bring it back up now, which has really had a positive impact on the river. We don't get as much thermal shock as we used to. Like I said, the biomass is better. I've been kicking the river every year for 30 years, so you just kind of see these trends. Yeah.
All right. So you got great fishing around here, awesome food, music scene. It's a pretty cool place to be.
It is, you know, and there didn't used to be a food scene here. You know, again, I grew up in Denver, and then when I moved here, it was pretty bleak. That, you know, there weren't a lot of restaurants that even stay open until 10 o'clock. Now there's some really great, places to eat.
Lines everywhere.
It is.
Do you have those professional? Like in DC, you can pay somebody to stand in line for you.
I'm sure that it's here. Why does the city get hot? Is what's kind of funny to me. How does Nashville become like the bridesmaid capital of the world now?
Bridesmaids capital?
Yeah.
Like hot women that you want to hook up with at weddings?
Well, they come here for, instead of Vegas, they're coming here now.
Like hen parties.
Yes.
Interesting.
Just crazy.
Those are always fun to hang out with at a bar.
It is. Yeah. Well, let me tell you, come here because they're here. I mean, just if it's lunchtime, you step out of here and you'll see them in the line over at Hattie B's. They'll all have the same T-shirt on.
Do they do the lifesavers tied to them?
There's all kind of things tied to them.
Yeah. Phallic straws.
Yeah, phallic straws or blow up. Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of that. But, you know, that's the other thing. Because it's a diverse fishery and it's a pretty fun town, a lot of people come here and they're like, oh, you have fishing here? Or they're like, oh, there's a fly shop here? Then you start talking about, you know, well, what do you want to catch? Do you want to catch trout? You want to go catch muskie? You want to catch smallmouth? You want to, you know, our striper fishery, there's some really big striper here that you just don't think about. I mean, if you are persistent and kind of figure some of this out, you're going to catch striper on the fly that are in excess of 40 pounds.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, there's
chasing the gizzard chads around, getting fat.
Yeah, yep. You know, and again, you know, they chase the gizzards depending on time of year, and if you're in the lake or if you're in the river, it's a really fun fishery. The Priest is one of the better hybrid lakes in the country. They grow really big hybrid bass there. And if you're Western guys, we always call them wipers. Here they call them hybrid. So it's white bass striper cross. But Priest has some really quality hybrid fishing in it. Yeah. Striper fishing used to be better, but, you know, we were talking about the lake just gets so warm in the winter, the striper, or in the summer now, the striper
hanging lethargic,
struggle a little
deep.
Bit, yeah, and they're not putting, that's a stocked fishery for us, so they don't put as many striper in Priest as they used to because the hybrid do better. There's
The hockey team did pretty damn good last season.
It was
better than us. Season. Capitals can't make it out of round two.
Yeah. Well, you know, it was great. I think what I enjoyed about it was they weren't expected to go past the first round. So it was fun. It was a fun season. The city was great. I think it brought a lot of, for hockey fans, it brought a lot of kind of positive attention to the city, even though we're in the South. It wasn't a sport that, you know, Southerners grew up on, but the city has embraced the Preds.
Where do they get the catfish they throw on the ice? Are those caught?
Probably out of the cover. You know, they probably go to some of the international markets and buy some catfish. Yeah. Yeah.
Fantastic. You ever get any of the musicians in here? You don't have to name names. I know a couple of them.
Yeah, you know, there are several that fish. And there's a few that are really dedicated. You know, when they're off the road, they fish. That's their pastime.
Inspiration for their music.
Yeah, you know, and just, you know, I think that life on the road can be kind of tough. So just getting out, having solitude on the river, they enjoy it.
Yeah. I got to hang out with Kings of Leon on the Salmon River steelhead fishing.
Yeah, you know, a lot of them have had some children here in the last few years.
Marrying Victoria's Secret models. Kayla's doing all right.
Yeah, yeah. Matt was the one that was really, one of the guitarists. He actually really caught the bug. But he's been a little busy with children lately.
Preaching in the choir.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
That's why, you know, I don't get out to fish in the Shenandoah Mountains. I don't drive 2 hours west of D.C. I fish locally because that's all I have time to do.
Well, you know, that's something we've stressed for a long time, is that, you know, if the southern tailwaters are at the mercy of hydroelectric power or flood control, and so it's a lot of times, if we've had a lot of rain, it can be weeks before there's wadeable water on the trout streams around here. And so for me, the option is, oh, don't fish or go do something else.
And when it's prime, is the parking lot full? Everyone knows it's hot. Let's all go fish.
But you can go, you know, you can go carp fishing. You can go smallmouth fishing. You know, we can drive 12 minutes from here and go catch quality smallmouth right in the
What's
city.
What's a quality smallmouth?
4 pounds.
Oh, yeah. See, I didn't bring any fishing gear. I always regret doing that.
I know you should always travel with fishing gear. You know, or, you know, you can go downtown and garfish. You can go out to Priest and catch hybrid. There's a lot of stuff in town. You know, we talked about skipjack. We talked about buffalo. You know, there's a lot of stuff in town that if the option is not to fish or just fish, I'm going to choose to fish. It's not, maybe chasing gar isn't my first love, but there's nothing wrong with catching a 4 or 5 foot fish.
Oh yeah.
You know, and you can do that. Again, you can do that right downtown. So yeah, diversity and diversify, we try and stress.
Do you offer guided trips for all these species?
We do. Yeah.
So if someone needs to book a trip, just call, email?
Just call the shop, yeah. I've got guys that specialize in, muskies are passion, or carps are passion, or trout's their passion, or smallmouth. Yeah, so.
You got someone to cater to each niche that someone wants.
Yeah. You know, I started a carp on the fly tournament 28 years ago.
People probably thought you were crazy.
We got beat up for carp fishing for a long time. I chuckle now that it's, you know.
It's caught on.
Yeah, because we got beat up.
They were never
for doing all of that.
You flip open a catalog, they didn't have any carp flies a couple years ago.
No.
No, it was dedicated sections.
Yeah, big sections, and, you know, and people are excited about it. And it's great. I mean, you know, that's the other thing here. You can chase grassies, you can chase commons, you can chase mirrors, you know. You got small and largemouth buffalo. You got drum. You got freshwater drum here.
Still,
I mean,
never seen a freshwater drum.
Oh, they're easy. They're really, if you got drum on the flat, you'll catch them.
My cousin said they're slimy. We went looking for them in Columbus.
Yeah, you know, there's certain times of the year where there's more on the flats than others, but if they're on the flat and you get a fly in front of them, they eat. They're not, which is kind of nice.
Yeah.
You know, if you make a good cast, you're rewarded. You know, instead of the buffalo where you make a good cast and they just kind of thumb their nose at it. But yeah, yeah.
So, how big do the buffalo or the drum?
Drum get big here. I don't see a lot of real big ones on the flats here. Most of what I see in the flats are going to be 5 to about 15. I haven't seen any real massive drum.
Are these soft flats? You sink when you go walking through them?
Yeah, that's
stinky.
And some of our flats, it's hard to see. You get some algae blooming, or if it's rained, there's a lot of sediment. So that's the tough part of especially flats off the Cumberland. They're not clear water, and when you have a lot of mud and fish, they kick up so much silt. You know, you know there's a fish in there, and you catch a glimpse of a tail, but a lot of times you don't know which way he's facing. A lot of times you hit the fish with the fly by accident because you can't see it. But you just have to take the shot and hope he finds it.
Last week we were on a mud flat. And my client dropped something in the water, and I heard like a plink.
Yep.
And I was like, whatever it is, it's gone. You're never. And we searched for it, and I'm like, I'm touching the mud, and I just. The hair on the back of my neck is standing up.
A lot of snapping turtles here. You know? Yeah, but, you know, again, I mean, I started chasing carp because I wanted to be a better saltwater flats fisherman. Well, when you live in the middle part of the country, you only get so many days in saltwater. So, you know, it was a way to keep in tune when, you know, I go permit fishing or bone fishing, you know, or red fishing, which to me made perfect sense. You know, again, you know, it's like there's, sure, you know, it's not really what you want to be catching, but how you do that is exactly how you do it when you're in saltwater. And so that, you know, for me, that was the impetus to start carp fishing here, was to stay tuned up for saltwater species.
Right. Fantastic. You've got Jen Ripple's got an event coming up in your shop soon?
She does, yeah. Jen moved down, I guess a little over a year ago, or coming up on a year. She kind of lives west of town, and we've been trying to get together. Her schedule and our schedules haven't meshed, but I think we finally got a date. Yeah, so we're excited about that. We've got some spay stuff coming in the fall. Trying to get our tying classes lined up as we kind of slide in the.
Do you do that in the shop?
Yeah, yeah.
Just move stuff around.
We have our tying classes. We have a classroom that we teach in, and then our. Our casting stuff is, depending on water, is either done in town here or we go out to the Caney Fork. So it just, you know, it's, we like to run it up there. It's a bigger system, but if they're generating, then we have to kind of regroup something in town here.
Okay. Anything else you want to mention? Anything else out there?
You know, not really. I mean, if you're sliding to Nashville, bring a rod.
Don't
be you. And you can, you know, just call one of the shops here and, you know, ask, is there anything going on? Really, the only thing that shuts the fishing down here is rain. We get a tremendous amount of rain. So, if we get a big rain, it just, you know, that's what shuts our fishing down. Really, you know, anything else besides that, there's 12 months out of the year, there is something you can catch on a fly rod here.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
What about eating? Where are your favorite spots to eat after a day of fishing?
You know, if you're looking for something quick, you know, Martin's Barbecue is a good one. He's a fly fisherman, so he's
okay. You know. help support.
Yeah, that. Yeah. And local business. Edley's is another one.
Oh my God, that
Edley's is good.
That Tuck Burger yesterday.
Yeah, and they fish. Tuck so, sandwich. You know, we try and support the people that support us. Yeah, but both those are good. That's the thing. There's so many good places now. It's like you can't choose anymore. Yeah,
I probably need to walk back to Virginia after all the food I've eaten this week.
Yeah, it can happen.
I'm not too poorly punished, but Bolton's yesterday. I went with the low mild.
Yeah, Bolton's can hurt you.
Yeah.
Yeah, don't ever tell them that they can't make it hot enough because, yeah.
I don't know who would eat the extra spicy.
Yeah.
If that's a food challenge or something, I'm not going to be a part of it.
Yeah, no, it'll hurt you. Yeah.
How did the whole hot chicken thing, do you know how that started around here?
You know, so it's always been here. But it was kind of an underground food scene. And a lot of those places were in parts of town that you didn't want to be in at night. And then when Hattie B's opened up across the street from us, their timing just was kind of impeccable. And I don't know who did their marketing or they just worked social media right. It just blew up. So a lot of people are amazed that Hattie B's hasn't been there longer than the 5 years they've been there. Because there's other places that have been there for a really long time.
How much chicken did you say they go through in a week?
Yeah, it's like crazy. It's like 10,000 pounds.
My gosh.
Yeah. Phenomenal business. But that really was the business that brought attention to the hot chicken scene in Nashville.
Okay.
Yeah. But Prince's, 400 Degrees, Bolton's, Pepper Fire, those have been around a long time. Hattie's is kind of the newer player. Yeah, yeah. They're all good, though. I mean, we tell people, you know, try them all, compare them.
I'm trying to do that.
They're all slightly different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fantastic. What about your website, online, social media? Where can people find you, contact you?
Yeah, so our online is down, getting reworked right now, and our website is about to get kind of reworked, but you know, flysouth.net,
that's where my email got bounced back,
right?
I did the .com.
.com, yeah.
.net because of phishing,
you know? No, there was actually some small airline that had .net when we started this business, so, or that had .com when we started this business, so we we're forced to kind of take .net.
Snowwhite.com is like car detailing in Florida.
Right, yeah.
Been upset with them for a long time.
Yeah. Yeah. Then, you know, we're on all the social media platforms except for Snapchat. But if you go to the website, you can get to everything else.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I appreciate the time today. This has been awesome.
Yeah, next time you need to call.
Yeah.
We'll get out and fish.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Hopefully the dinosaur park up here will be open so my daughter can play there.
It should be.
Yeah, it's still under construction. Look at all the mosaic stuff on it.
Yeah, that people, it drives you crazy. People get in there and pick the mosaic off and they have to restore it every now and then.
That sucks.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but it's a good park.
Yeah. Clean bathroom.
Sometimes.
All right. Thanks so much.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Awesome.
Thank you for joining us for the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast. For more information or to contact Rob, please go to www.robsnowwhite.com.